talk to you tonight. You know, Robert, let's start with you. This hugely, hugely iconic character, Freddy Krueger, who obviously has just blown the walls off horror, as it is. How do you take a character like that from the page and just bring him to life in such an incredible, memorable way?
I didn't have him in my mind's eye. A lot of times when we get jobs, Lisa and I, you know, they'll call us up and tell us we've got the part, or we go in for an audition and you see it in your mind's eye. You see yourself in that role. Obviously with Freddy, it's kind of hard to imagine yourself in that role. So it was with the magic of David Miller and countless afternoons deep in the San Fernando Valley, in his garage, in a barber's chair, experimenting with the makeup, looking at photos of burn victims, going through the long, long process with the colostomy bag, glue, the medical adhesive, and the different modifications, the different thicknesses, and the different textures. All that time, all those hours, all that heavy metal music in the background playing on David's boombox, remember it was the 80s, and looking in the mirror and being itchy and being irritated, I began to move my face underneath the latex to animate it. And I began to get a little grumpy because of the process and because of the constant poking with brushes and chopsticks and anything else David could think of to modify the makeup or to accent it or to mold it. And I found the voice. I found the voice swearing once, and I saw it in the mirror, and I think I just had enough, and I said to myself, God damn it! And I caught myself in the mirror, swearing, and in a guttural voice, and I knew that I could play with that. I knew I had something there. And I had moved my face enough that the face of Freddy was really moved. And then I realized that there were some old acting tricks from the theater, and Lisa's had a lot of training as well, and she knows you do a lot of classes about the face as a mask, passive mask and an active mask. And I began to use some of those tricks that I kind of put in a drawer, because film acting is different than stage acting, and I kind of put some of those tricks in a drawer, and I kind of opened that drawer mentally and began to use some of those old tricks. So that's sort of how I found him. The other kind of psychological component to this answer is that I was, in the first week of shooting the original film, very, very hot, summer of 1984, at the old Desilu Studios in Hollywood, where they shoot I Love Lucy. They also shot The Partridge Family there, and The Dick Van Dyke Show, and here we are in our dirty little nasty horror movie. And I've been there since 4 a.m. It's like 89 degrees out, hot and smoggy, and I'm getting touched up for a sequence, and in waltzes Heather Langenkamp, who looks like a 5'4", gorgeous Brooke Shields at that time, and Johnny Depp, two of the arguably two of the most beautiful kids in Hollywood. And Johnny had the best hair in the world then. He had like dry rockabilly Elvis hair. He could go like that and say, "Baroop." And I look over, and I'm being poked, and they're putting glue on me, and it smells, and it's hot, and it's itchy, and they're repairing around my mouth, because God forbid, I had a salad for lunch, and the dressing ruined the glue down around my mouth, and I'm thinking, you know, Robert, you're starring in a television show, people finally know your name, you've done 15 movies, maybe this was a bad decision, and I look over at Johnny and beautiful Heather, sitting there in their barber chairs, and their makeup girl gives them little tiny plastic fans to keep them cool. They don't even need makeup. They're so beautiful. These kids don't need makeup. They're like that handsome and beautiful. And now they've got little fans to keep them cool. And for a second, I was just as I'm describing it now, you see I can get back to that moment. And I realized when I had that reaction the first time, this jealousy this envy of youth and beauty. I can use it, because what is Freddie doing? He's killing children. And what are children? They're the future. Freddie's killing the future. And so I could use that moment of jealousy, these two young actors with their whole careers ahead of them. Here I am, 30 years old, you know, doing this horror movie. And maybe I made the wrong decision. And my envy for Johnny Depp, and my envy for young Heather Langenkamp, and my envy of their beauty, and the fact that they had their entire careers ahead of them, I can consolidate that into an instant synapse and use it as anger on the set. I can summon it up. And so that, combined with those hours and hours in front of the mirror while David Miller prodded me, you know, with his chopsticks from lunch and anything else he could find in the makeup room, those combined to just sort of get me in the mood and find the voice and a psychological sort of truth that I could use as Freddie. And that's sort of like the door for me in the character.
And so then as the movies progress,
every good joke, every line you love that Freddie cracked wise with, that's a right word. I came up with Welcome to Primetime B word, because I see some children out there. I came up with that one because it was something like, oh, now Jennifer, you've achieved the big time, I think, or something. It didn't sound like Freddie. But, and there's one or two in Freddie versus Jason that are mine, but everything else is written. If you look back at the cameraman, and you look back at the writers of Nightmare on Elm Street, they all have Oscars. They're some of the biggest players in the business, Brian Hegelin. I mean, check these guys out. The guy that wrote Shawshank Redemption, Frank Darabont. They're some of the biggest guys playing around in town now. And you know, both of us were recipients of that great dialogue and plotting.
And so, Lisa, coming on in the fourth film, what was it like for you, you know, seeing the first film, and then what was it like for you coming into the franchise?
Well, I've always been a fan of horror since I was a little grasshopper, as they say. So I was already familiar with the Nightmare on Elm Street series. So needless to say, when I booked the role of Alice Johnson in Nightmare 4, I was ecstatic. And then, of course, to reprise the role again in Nightmare 5. So it was something I completely embraced. I was familiar with the films and many horror films up to that point. I was a big, avid reader of horror as well. So, yeah, it was like a really good birthday present, because our first day of filming was my birthday, April 27th. So, anyway.
Yeah. I have to tell you guys a quick story about this lovely actress. I knew Lisa as an actress for years, and I knew Lisa as a pro, a professional, and that's how we related. But I had never seen Lisa in her real clothes. And Lisa came to my wedding reception because we had a great professional relationship at that time. We're friends now. We've had plenty of cocktails from around the world together. But back then, we were like professional friends. And Lisa came to my wedding reception. And I'm married to a fabulous woman, beautiful lady.
Yes.
And Lisa upstaged her at my wedding reception because I'd only seen this girl with no makeup, red hair in her face, fake perspiration, and acid wash denim. Because she's in Jeopardy, you know. She's Alice in Jeopardy, Alice in Wonderland, Alice in Hell, Alice in the Nightmare. So now I walk into my reception at the hippest restaurant in Silver Lake on Sunset Boulevard, and I come in the door, and there's this gorgeous woman with a cigarette, and as we say in Hollywood, the little black dress, and it's Lisa in high heels and a black mini skirt with a little décolletage and strapless, and Nancy and I both fell in love with her all over again. She was so beautiful. But it's so funny because I had known Lisa for all those movies only in the wardrobe and clothing of Alice, and she moved differently. She gestured differently. She animated her face differently. And here I'm looking at this phenomenally gorgeous woman, you know, with a cigarette in one hand and a martini in the other, at the bar, and every guy in the entire reception was staring at him. But it was so strange because I realized, in hindsight, how Lisa dampened all of that down and had to hide that and had to throw out all of those gifts that she has as a beautiful young woman to play Alice. Not that Alice is unattractive, but that she threw out all those things that she can use in other roles and use in her success as an actress. And I think you told a story once. Lisa, was it, you were a UCLA blonde, right?
Oh, yes.
She was a UCLA blonde, and of course she had that mousy hair.
Yes.
That mousy red wash.
Yep, a rinse
on,
put on my hair.
Rinse on for all those years. And it's not the real Lisa. I mean, Lisa, it was a real blonde. UCLA, you know,
Barbizon makeup,
yeah,
and everything.
Yeah, and so it's she had the courage. There's a thing called that, a really great compliment that Lisa and I are watching a movie or actors together say about other actors, and we just say, "No vanity," and it's like one of the nicest things you can say about somebody as an actor. They've sacrificed their vanity for a role, and we all know what that's about. It's like gaining weight, where people, you know, actors that gain weight or lose weight. Christian Bale, Marlon Brando, you pick one. But Lisa, I had known Lisa for years, but she was Alice. I really knew Lisa, the professional actress, playing Alice. And that was the first time I ever met, and then the first night I ever talked to Lisa, you know. And I always tell that because I've heard her tell the blonde story, the UCLA blonde story. But it's true. I mean, that's how dedicated and how deep into that role she was.
Could you talk a little bit about how Alice developed from 4 into 5? You know, in the beginning of 4, she's a little bit more timid. She's a little bit more reserved. And then, you know, by the end, she's leaping through the looking
glass.
She's
mad as hell.
Absolutely. And then, you know, you get into 5, and she's found herself, and she's a lot more confident. So tell us a little bit about that development.
Well, again, speaking of screenwriters, the script was written so beautifully. The character arc that Alice takes from daydreamer, shy wallflower to kick-ass ninja warrior is phenomenal, but that is due to the script, and it's about that way that character evolves and the evolution of her. It's just amazing the way it was written. Now, as a performer, as an actor, I mean, that's a dream role to play, to have that character arc happen and get to do it. Now, and of course, what I recall is, as you know, when you're filming, you don't film in order of the script. I mean, you could be filming the last scene on the first day and vice versa, and it's all over the place. So it was really important to me to keep track of where I was at, Alice was at, as far as how she had evolved. And part of her evolution comes from she's taking on characteristics of her friends as they die. And she doesn't bring on only their strong and, you know, admirable characteristics. She's also taking on characteristics like the scene in the bathroom when I start smoking a cigarette. Kristen's died, she smoked, and I'm like, I don't smoke, you know. But in the script, I needed to take careful care to keep track of who had died by what scene. So if we're doing scene 17, I know, okay, Kristen's died here. We're doing scene 52, 3 other friends have died. So what character, so I knew what persona to put on for each scene so that it could be believable about Alice's character arc, okay? So, and to have different levels. So that's the process that an actor has to go through when you do play a character that has such change happen in 95 minutes, you know? So, yeah. And it's also, Alice is completely me in junior high. Absolutely, I read. Grade school, I read books, I stayed home. I'm from St. Louis originally, and all right, and there was this really cute guy, Alan Edick, who lived next door. I was literally, like Alan, like looking out the window and seeing him play soccer and going, I wish he noticed me, you know, so I had that longing just like Alice did. So anyway, it's a little bit about the development.
Thank you so much. So, you know, coming up as actors, both when you were young, which actors, actresses most inspired you? You know, who most influenced you in your early days as actors?
Well, as a child, my parents took me everywhere. I'm an only child. And I saw On the Waterfront, the premiere.
Where's my mask?
And I remember when it opens with a guy being thrown off the roof. very terrifying. But I knew as a little child that Marlon Brando was special. And I also saw East of Eden as a child. And I was taken with the way James Dean moved. So I knew he was extraordinary. Much later in life, I rediscovered Cary Grant and Katharine Hepburn and Henry Fonda and Jimmy Stewart. I starred in a movie with Henry Fonda at one point in the 70s. But I started out with those. But what happened to me was I became an Anglophile, which means I became obsessed with British, English actors, which is much more common now. Shows like Downton Abbey and Game of Thrones and Lord of the Rings, we're much more familiar with a lot of the British actors. But when I was in just starting college, there was a thing called the English New Wave, which was the first kind of kitchen sink reel movies coming over from London with actors like Alan Bates and Albert Finney, people like that. Joan Plowright, just wonderful, wonderful actors of that time, Oliver Reed. And I became obsessed with all of the sort of angry young British actors for quite a long time. And that influenced me very heavily. I even went away to the Royal Academy because of that. I was very lucky to be accepted there. And it sort of changed my life. I was a snob for a while, but I think it really stretched me as well, because a lot of what I learned then I can use now, especially as an older actor. A lot of that stuff, I would not be playing the roles I'm playing now. I wouldn't be nearly as busy had I remained the actor I was in the 70s. The kind of actor I was, and had I not done horror and had those doors open up for me internationally. So I was very influenced by the Brits as a young man, and my friends in college, and then when I went to the Royal Academy, obviously I had teachers that taught Peter O'Toole and Susanna York from Albert Finney and Alan Bates. And all of them. I had the exact same teachers, and now I was an adult, I was old enough to drink. And I can remember going to the pub with these teachers, and they would tell me stories about so-and-so getting his teeth fixed, or so-and-so being pregnant, or so-and-so getting a nose job. But they treated me like an equal, and yet these were the people that had taught these actors that I idolized. And that access gives one confidence, and that's a very important happy accident to my career.
I think for me, it would have to be hands down Meryl Streep. I know we all, but her ability, her chameleon ability, just fascinated me. I mean, from Kramer versus Kramer to Sophie's Choice, French Lieutenant's Woman. I mean, she just could play anything and everything, and I was fascinated by that to play all those different kind of characters. And so I think when I look back at my career, I have played from nuns to prostitutes, okay? And different kind of makeup and wardrobe and hair to where you don't recognize Meryl Streep in a lot of these. You know, I mean, you know what she looks like because you see her in interviews and whatnot, but to me that got me excited to be able to play all these different characters that we're all under. And I feel really fortunate to have been cast, other than the way I look, that I'm a, you know, we're trained professionals and we can play a whole variety of roles. Another influence was that I studied Grotowski. And everyone's like, what the hell is that? It's a form of acting that comes out of Poland. And I studied at UCLA, but then at night I was studying Grotowski. And it's a very intense study. It's really about getting into the body. Imagine this phrase. Imagine your hair crying. So it got my head into this whole other arena, and I actually went to Poland for 6 weeks. I studied there as well, and 2 years of Grotowski. So I think that shaped me, because I'm this Midwestern girl, and I knew that I needed to break out of my bubble and needed to just learn something completely outrageous, you know, so that I could play the characters that I wanted to play.
I saw Grotowski play. It's amazing physical theater director, changed a lot, and I saw a kind of chanting, repetitive play of his about the concentration camps. And it's one of those life-changing things that you see. You know, there's a play, and it'll come, it'll probably come into Providence if it hasn't already played. It may come to, well, I'm talking about another one now. Changing the subject, you guys are so lucky here. You have Trinity Square, which when I was a young actor, a young stage actor, was the most desired place to work in America. ACT in San Francisco, Trinity Square here, and the Guthrie in Minnesota were better than most of the theaters in New York at that time, especially in terms of the avant-garde. And this production I saw, seeing Peter Brook's Midsummer's Night Dream, seeing some of these shows changes your perception. If the curious incident of a dog in the nighttime comes to Providence, you guys, it's playing in New York still, but if the tour comes here, you guys have to see it because it will change the way you see. Just like certain songs, certain rock songs, or certain rap songs, or certain reggae songs change the way you listen, or progressive jazz, or certain films go beyond what we've seen before. I just saw The Shape of Water, Guillermo del Toro's movie, which is both new and old-fashioned at the same time. And I just saw in 3D IMAX Blade Runner 2049, which is an entirely different world. A director's imagination completely achieved. Now it's long. You know, Blade Runner's not quick, shoot 'em up, Michael Bay, bang, bang, kiss, kiss. But it is a different world. You go into a different world, and it's a mystery, and it's mythic. And Shape of Water is one man literally getting his imagination up on the screen. So you guys have both of those to look forward to if you haven't already seen them. They're great, great things.